morning and Vaheguru Ji Ka Khalsa.
Vaheguru Ji Ka
Khalsa. Those of you who know me, you know I'm not going to be talking in any conventional style. Since the topic is also on youth, and one of the first lessons we need to learn is don't bore people. Most, you know, I'm one of those who would come to these conferences and other places and would be like, what the hell are they talking about? Hearing some laughs and some heads are shaking. Well, that's what we're going to do today. We're going to try to see if we can shake up the system a bit. I heard what the earlier opening addresses were, and Mr. Gurdwara, through the board, in this 50 years of celebration, has put together a conference. I'm sure you don't want anything status quo, because if Sikhs who have been here for 150 years, if they didn't come here as a status quo, that's what I want you guys to think about. Then why would we continue to do things which maintains the status quo? And that's where we are losing our youth. What we say versus what we project as an image are two very different things. Dr. IJ Singh, I call him IJ Uncle. He says Uncle is not my last name, but I still call him IJ Uncle. Some of you might have read his books. He says there is a yawning gap between precept and practice. And that's where I come into the picture. I want to talk about, really, we don't want to tell our youngsters what to do. That's not our job. We actually never told them what to do. But somehow, in the last two, three generations, we just love telling them what to do, as if we have the answers. Do we? So why do we continue to have the same inputs and expect a different output? It's not going to produce a different output. And that's where I want to focus on this. You know, I think I'm overdressed for this place. I threw my chewing gum outside, I put maybe tomorrow I'll come in my flip-flops and t-shirt on. Okay. So, you know, the thing is, you're getting my point that, you know, looking around, you know, Punjabi together, Bibi Adariya Wale, the Bade Bate, but what about the black one, you know? It's very chitty of me. And the issue, Goethe has said this, any nation which is interested in changing its destiny, they better worry about what people below the age of 25 are thinking. Do you know what the Singapore Sikhs below the age of 25 are thinking? What are they talking about when they're sipping their latte? That's what we need to address. And I will try to share with you what does the Sikh doctrine in its original impetus as presented in the Guru period and Guru Granth Sahib, dealt with these issues. We are not the modern minority. Let me break that for you. We never were. You know what modern minority? In America, they said the same thing. Modern minority is a term, phrase, coined by the rulers, the regimes, the establishment, to say now you're acting like us. Guru Nanak was not a modern minority during his time. He actually challenged the establishment. Guru Granth Sahib's words are, "Jithe neej samaliya," where you take care of the underdogs and the downtrodden. In today's parlance, that means where you take care of underrepresented and unrepresented peoples and nations. Nalar teri bakshis, this is where we see the grace. And he clarifies there, because people like me, we like to justify everything mentally. He says, "I'm not here to emulate or copy the establishment," and his words are, "Vadeya siyon kyaris." Vadeya is established. Really, our work is those of us who are interested in the house of Guru Nanak, not to become the establishment, but how do you challenge the establishment, which essentially is about not being status quo. That's our whole history. The whole of Guru period history is this, the whole of 18th century is this. The starting of Singapore Sikhs is this. So, if we are seriously interested in this, we're going to have to do some unlearning. The learning which has happened with us, you know, if you want to invoke Edward Said, fine. If you want to invoke, if some of you are, you know, academic types here, Michel Foucault, that's the kind of stuff we have to think about as well. What identity, what information are we really sharing? And is that really the Sikh thesis? So this is not, I'm not going to talk about development, I'm going to talk about what I call it, nurture and empower. We are really about how do you make people feel good about themselves fill them with such an inspiration that they are going to go tackle what people are not tackling. That's the heritage we actually carry. So in that heritage, we need to first talk about what really is the Sikh thesis. How do we deal with the children? Not how we are dealing with it, how we used to deal with it. What really is, does it mean to empower them? Right? And I'm going to play with some images too. You saw my opening image, the 30 million Sikhs. Every time we show a Sikh image, how come it looks like an androcentric male image? We are ignoring the half of the population from a gender angle, and probably 90% who yet have not decided to embrace the Khalsa identity. Why do we ignore that? We need to confront that. That's part of us. We are a big tent. This tent's got room for all 30 million of us worldwide. And we better have this discussion internally. We better have the spaces for every youngster and old, but we focus on youngsters. We gotta have space for everyone. That's the heritage. An individual makes a conscious choice what level of Sikhi observation they want to bring in their lives. And that's directly proportional to their roles and contributions in history and society. We are not the moral police of the soft Taliban. We better not become that. You know, I'm beginning to see some of that all over the world. What I choose to become is between me and my guru. We should share the ideals, but realize people who have not even given commitment, a formal commitment into Sikhi, don't belittle them. We fought with that. Gurus fought with those who did that. That was the whole struggle in Sikhi. The Qazi, the Mullah, the Yogi, the three words Guru Nanak invokes. He says, Tina Ujade ka band, that they are the heights of destruction. People who claim to understand religion completely, they are the troublemakers. And gurus fought with them. So we better not become one of those, and we are becoming one of those. Today's hukum from Darbar Sahib, when I woke up at a 3:20 call this morning from America, you know, after a few cups of coffee in my room, I looked up the hukum of Darbar Sahib. You know what the opening line is? I think it's very instructive. The opening line is, Karam taram pakhand jyoti sah, fin jam jagati lutai. The karmic, religious, visible reality you see is hypocrisy. This is not my word, this is Guru Arjan's. The visible reality of religion and karmic theories is hypocrisy, and it is looting the whole world by selling them fear of death. Just think about that. Are you ready for that Guru wisdom? The one who's telling you that the whole karmic idea, the whole religious idea, the world is invoking, is actually the trouble. Jab jagati lutai. And we are being, you know, yesterday I used a phrase in Gurdwara, I use it here. Religion has become just like, you know, what we have cartels in the world. It thrives on extortion. That's what Guru Nanak confronted. I think as parents, which I'll share tomorrow, we get into that. I want to talk about Gurbani's state. I want to talk about what did gurus do in 240 years, what ideas were developed, what does today's educational psychology say about these things? And how to make all of this relevant to us in 2015 sitting here in Singapore? So let's start with this inspiration. This is a phrase from Professor Puran Singh, quote from his book, Spirit-Born People. I want you to pay attention to the title of this book, Spirit-Born People. It doesn't say law-born people. We are not the people of the law. There are other communities like that, Unamu Mubarak Hove, but that's not us. Don't emulate that. Sada kaam se Punjabi ch kehte hain, Ruh paa deni, Ruh di kharaab deni. Ruh is spirit. And let's get into this. He says, according to the Guru, the true education of person is her self-study of soul. To attain to heights and to maintain them, to gather greater and greater strength in her soul. It is the strength of the poet's imagination. It is that intensity that burns and whose light no darkness can dim. You know who interpreted this in the last 20 years beautifully in his life? His name is Jaswant Singh Khalra. His last speech when he gave in Ottawa, he's a human rights lawyer in 1995. He was extrajudicially killed by the Indian government, Punjab police. He uses this idea. He says, it's not a question of how many people are parting darkness. The question is, even if one light does not confront darkness, about confronting darkness within us. This is what we should be transferring the values to our youth. Our youngsters, how do you confront darkness within you such that your surut, your consciousness becomes so developed that you can also then confront the darkness in the community you live in? Now, I'm a Star Wars fan. I love this analogy. We are all supposed to be Jedi warriors. Just remember the Jedi warrior, Darth Vader used to be one. So we all have this capacity. The idea is, which capacity are you building in your youth? Or are you even building any capacity? We are supposed to be building this capacity of light. The word is Jyot in Gurmani, which essentially has to do with not telling them what to do, but giving them the capacity so they can figure out what to do themselves. Guru Nanak did not belong to a model that as he did whatever his dad said. Don't mind me saying that. He belonged to a model where he says, I'm going to develop some clear thinking and let me go figure out how to develop that clear thinking. Okay, so he says true education, I'm going to skip, and he says true education does not make you patriotic. These are the words we use today. I'm an American, I'm a Singaporean, I'm an Indian. You're seeing hypersensitivity of this. We drape ourselves in the flags of the countries we live in. Americans do this too. Everyone's doing it. Is that what an educated is, or is it a false sense of patriotism? Because you know, everywhere in the world, including the most liberal societies in the world of Scandinavia, have elected right-wing governments in the last 10 years. So this false sense of patriotism is not going to get us anywhere. We need to be giving them some incredible values. And what are those values? He says a truly educated and cultured person is the one whose godlike manners bring her the spontaneous kinship of the all races of human beings, regardless of what country, what religion, what sexuality you carry. I'm going to add these words today because LGBTQ is an issue in the world. We better figure out how to confront it. It's not the old casteist mentality only, although that still exists. If you don't believe that, just check out day before yesterday, they released a documentary in India, Operation Black Rain. You should see how 144 Dalits were killed by the upper caste Ranveer Sena, and nobody gives a damn. Really, the cultured person, what we are after, what we must be after, is not that my son or my daughter is going to look like me. That could be one of the milestones if we choose to have it. But are they going to carry the values which will give them kinship of the ages? Like Puran Singh says, Ranja was the Sikh of the Guru before the Guru. I don't know if we can get that. He also says Walt Whitman is a Sikh born in America. What is he talking about? He's talking about in the absence of values, in the absence of feeling the pain as Guru Nanak is presented, the one who felt the pain of the world, the one who identified with the peoples of the world. Regardless, even when there's a genocide, Guru Nanak is identifying in his own words, I not only feel the pains of the Muslim, Hindu women, the Rajput women, the Dalit women, he says, I also feel the pain of Muslim women who are reading Qurans in the houses of the Mughal invaders. What is that level of sensitivity? Can we even imagine that sensitivity? That's what we are supposed to be developing. That's the true education. We have literates now, we have degrees, we love to get, talk about that. That's okay, that just means that you are not trained to make some money. That's all that means. That doesn't mean you are educated. Education is an entirely different piece. If anpad banda bhi educated ho sakda, Gurbani Devi Lakshmi Dana Nagya, Padaya, Murakha, Kiyaja, Love, Love, Hankar. You know, what good am I going to do with the number of degrees you have if you haven't figured out how to use that idea and transfer it into changes of behavior? Some of you, I was reading the profile, some of you will be leading the groups. In fact, two of you are in psychology. That's great to see this. We need to figure out how to use more psychologists into these things. They understand behavior patterns. And this is what education is about. Youth empowerment, if you are interested in it, and I'm calling it nurturing. You don't harness. We tell our youngsters what to do. We got to stop doing that. We got to give them, I say we got to show them how to take a great flight. Create larger wings, strong wings, so they can fly better than you and I have. And how do you do this? Well, let's first talk about what really is the word empowerment. And power, the first bullet is giving them the power or authority. Are you ready to do that? Are you really ready? I mean, I haven't seen too many examples of that. Exceptions aside, if 85% of the normal population curve is not doing it, mostly it's men running our affairs. Men above 60 and 70. We blame the ugly politics. What about you and me? We haven't empowered anyone. Every guru transferred leadership while they were alive. They didn't look at the age, they looked at the right criteria. Are you really wanting to empower the youth? I'm going to really ask that. I don't think we are ready for it. Can you imagine today a Jathedar who's 16 years old? Guru Arjan was 16 when he became the uncontested leader of a Sikh nation. Can you imagine today, Maipago? America is debating this week. They just qualified two women to fight in infantry, and they still are not aligned them as rangers in the army in America. This week this happened. And 300 years ago, we dealt with that. We said, if one has the capacity, they can also be infantry fighters. And you should visit her place where she lived, about 14 kilometers from Azusa, Maipago. We are not the people who look at the skin or the gender or the ethnicity or the language they speak or what they eat or what music they listen to bring it to today's context. We really need to be looking at what do they carry. Value proposition of an individual, we call it. And corporations, we say it. I said, all about individuals. And this is what empowerment is. You actually are, today if you ask me, there should be no more teaching. The teaching world is changing. There are no more teachers, now we have enablers. People who enable the next person to take on the leadership roles. We have no system in the world where we are implementing this among the Sikhs. We got some serious challenges ahead of us. So think about what does the Singapore Sikhs look like in the next 25 years, next 10 years, maybe even next 5 years. You know, the best strategic plan in the world is done by U.S. Air Force. They stopped making even a 5-year plan. You know what they do now? 1-year plan. And let me relate this to Sikhi. Sikhs used to do 6-month plans. We used to call them Jodhvedas. We used to come together as a community, historically, generally speaking, during Vaisakhi and during Diwali. They would decide what's the project for the community. This is a SMART goal we talk about today. The T in the SMART goal is the time. What's the deadline? If there's no deadline, it ain't going to happen. They used to give, every Sikh used to give themselves a deadline of 6 months. They used to come with something which is specific. It was, and they would all work on it and they would deliver by the time they met. Adopt a SMART goal as a community. What is the SMART goal for people below the age of 25 in Singapore Sikhs? That's what the elders, the Buddha, as we call them traditionally, that's what they really should be thinking about. So, are you ready to give them the authority or the power? Are you wanting them to enable this? These are the questions all of you should be asking. In today's system of education, we don't talk about this. This is what the world is after. We basically are, you know, we call them now, we don't even have thinkers who are coming out of education. And you know this, there's a huge debate globally. This is not just among Sikhs, but we are not immune from it, so we are party to it as well. Edward de Bono is a leading educator in the world, the guy who wrote, you know, Sikh thinking hats and vertical thinking and things of that nature. He essentially, he talks about this. Bunch of people are talking about it. Today, we just have application users. We don't have thinkers. And unless you create thinkers, you will never know what's the next thing to do. You're just creating another process. The corporate slavery is one word for it, if you want to choose the leftist perspective. All you're doing is creating some system, Punjabi, which is called Gali Gate. You're laughing, but that's exactly what it is. If you want Gurbani, Maj Ki Vaar has this whole system defined. Guru Nanak describes it beautifully. He says, you know what happens? You're born, you play with things. I'm going to talk about this more in the people's thing tomorrow from the family angle. But point is, this is what our youngsters are going through. This is a system. If you want to come out of this system, you have to do different things. So what are the different things? Current focus is all about education and career. And let me change that. It's not even education. It's actually about the license to go get a particular job. Now, What happens then is, then you know, Harvard did a survey last year of their graduating class of lawyers. So this is what Ivy League is up to. They asked them a question. Would you lie if your boss asked you? 87% said yes. This tells you what we are teaching, even in the best and the brightest in the world. Then they asked them, would you do illegal things? 83% said yes. Because everything is incentivized. That's what we do. We are really not thinking about, is it ethically the right thing to do? Is it morally the right thing to do? Those who do it, Julian Assange is one name, maybe it's not a common name to use in Singapore, but I'm going to use it. He's thinking. He actually single-handedly forced America to change, NSA to change its policy. And he's public enemy declared by America. I would say he's acting in a very Sikh-like manner, holding people responsible. Transparency is what government says, and we are not demanding. So my point is, if this is the focus, we are never going to produce what we're supposed to be producing. We're supposed to be actually breaking the cycle. Traditional Gurmukhi on this is Churasi da Gir Dharma. That's a traditional classical interpretation. That's also a cycle. The Gadi Gir is a cycle. You're going through the motions. If you want to come out of this motion, you've got to do something different. If you're only being trained to go this, because then you get your promotion, then you get your Sikhi. We have done the same thing in Sikhi. You know, you go through these motions. Today's Hukum said this, these motions are not going to create anything. So, question to us is, how do you break this cycle? What does nurturing and empowerment look like for us? I call this, how do you bring the cognitive element and the spirit elements together? Surt is consciousness. Ru is spirit. There is a thinking which has to be developed, which has to do with, you know, kind of like IQ kind of stuff. And there is an emotion which has to be developed, which is the EQ kind of stuff. And there are other quotients too these days. You have health quotients and other things. I'm not going to get into it. But what I'm essentially saying is, we definitely are lacking in the thinking element. And the spirit element, it becomes visible when there's a crisis. Otherwise, it's missing too. In a crisis, we love to save the day. We love being heroes. Or sheroes. We don't even talk about them. It shows you how messed up our development process is. We totally ignore the people that have to develop. Where are our heroes? We should be asking this. How come it's always his story? What about her story? These are the questions we have to raise when we talk about Sikhi as well. They existed. They weren't the writers. Maybe they weren't allowed to participate. What is going on? We need to ask these questions. So coming back to it, how do you create that surt and how do you develop this roof? Essentially combining the two elements such that you have a very explosive child. I don't mean literally. Explosive personality is the one which defies all the odds and goes out and becomes like a new Malala. She's defying the odds. She's not following the system. She's not following the establishment. You all know this. The world loves this. But if somebody does this in your house, you get a worry. Punjabi jo kehnde hai, apna dil ya Bhagat Singh ho raha, saade karna. That's the syndrome we have to get out of. In fact, we have to start saying, I want in my house to be the next Jaswant Singh Kalra. I want the next Balbir Kaur to be in my house. I want the next Dr. Anar Kalikar Kuniyar to be in my house. The woman at age of 24 in Afghanistan. Today, medical doctor, human rights activist, and the women of the year in Afghanistan. 3 years ago. If you ask for this, you might get it. But maybe we are asking for other things, so we are not getting it. So how do we do? Surat is, multiple meanings are listed there. All I want to say is, let me actually invoke Guru Nanak Sahib here. People ask me, you know, and community fights about who's a Gurmukh. We all get into the physical identity. I want to get away from it for a second. You know when Guru Nanak defines it? I love his expression. He says, Gurmukh na dang. Gurmukh ve dang. Gurmukh reha samadhi. Person who brings the left brain and the right brain together and has integrated those two ideas and constantly lives in their realm, that's the Gurmukh. Nadang is musical elements, Vedang is literary elements. This is what today's Briggs Myers talks about, how you develop complete personalities. This is what the psychology tests are about. This is where people are helping. This is Guru Nanak's model. His model is, some people today say, poetry should treat the Ami Mandir. Why Ami Mandir? You will never develop certain senses. Why are we not encouraging our youngsters to write the best novel out there? The best music video out there? Why are we only asking them to follow the traditional jobs? How come they are not the best graphic designers? Right? This is the Nanan and Vedan business, without even bringing Sikhi into it directly and classically. This is the stuff our brain, you know, is supposed to be working to bring it together. Anyway, so essentially, let's invoke a little bit of a Sikhi, so you don't think it's all about gibberish out there. It's not. Sikhi, what is Sikhi? Sikhi is about lifestyle. Your choices in lifestyle. And in that choices, people offer us political ideologies. Our youngsters, the 3:20 a.m. call I had this morning, it was from a parent, from a Gurdwara president, who was also a leader of a national Sikh organization in America. Guess what his pain point was? He called me at 3:20. My son doesn't know. He's going to college. He doesn't want to keep his girl. I said, well, uncle, it's kind of late in the game. I'm not going to talk to him. I want to talk to you first. You know why it's late in the game? My focus has been external identity. We have not done what's called transvaluation in the community. We have not transferred the values. We got to work on transferring the values. We are pain, and I am pain too, but this is, you know, I think it's a little bit mislocated. The pain is coming from something we desire, but not something where we have actually built them as individuals based out of Sikh models. And the Sikh model says, we got to figure out how do we create and develop an individual such that they're able to take on, and I say take on, and let them experiment in your homes. You need to experiment. Let them make all the mistakes at home. We don't even allow them to make mistakes. We don't allow them to even challenge things. Let them challenge. Isn't that the Guru Nanak model? He challenged everything. Maybe we are not ready for it, but if you really want Sikhi, the next level, you know, the outcome will be this. They will learn to take on the religious leaders. And believe me, religious leaders need to be taken on. This is Guru Nanak Shabad. He says, I want to redefine the jogi. I want to redefine the Brahman. I want to redefine the Qazi. And I just highlighted some words, put some contemporary English to it. These are the characteristics we want in the people, according to Guru Nanak. If you want to develop a great child, he says, I want to have clarity in that child. I want him to have grace, realization, activism. We don't even like this word anymore. We think it's reserved for the Marxists. No, it's not. Courage, reflection, leadership. Essentially, he's saying, don't buy this classical definitions of these words. He's redefining everything. This is Guru Nanak for you. A very dangerous Guru Nanak, the one we are not used to. He's dangerous because he's anti-establishment. He's dangerous because he refuses to accept, you know, the term legal and illegal? You know what's illegal? Illegal is something, the policy which is waiting to be changed. That's what illegal is. That's what Nelson Mandela did. I went to his jail cell in Robben Island. 27 years he spent in there. You know why? Because he says, I'm not putting my gun down because that's how we fought until you give one man one vote equation. 27 years he spent in the jail cell. The dog's compartment for the white officers there had a bigger room than his jail cell. My point is, this is what happens worldwide. Just because something is illegal, and I'm not saying, you know, become criminal, that's a very different thing. Political dissidents are something we need to study. Every guru was a political dissident, just so you know. They spent time in jail. Not because they were criminals, because they were working to change policies. Nanak did it too. Chakki PC apagaye. Chhewe guru spent time in Gwalior jail. And when they were releasing him, it wasn't enough for him to say, let me go. He says, no, I want every single political dissident gone from here. That's the Bandi Chhod Divas. Are we ready for that? Real Sikhi, real empowerment, when you take people in the leadership positions and you turn upside down and say, now let's make it van glorious, power to the people idea. So Sikhi as a traditional religion, we can't understand it because we are not equipped to, because it is not a traditional religion. This was all about, maybe the word revolution should be used to invoke what happened, because this is what they did. And I know I'm getting a little political, so let me come back to education. Some of you might be getting a little tense. So here are our educators, the legacy of empowered. If I can make this graph for all sorts of people, I just chose to do it on educators. And these are our educators. They are linguists, but I want to just mention to you, our linguists, our granthi, Baba Bhutan, we probably say was the first granthi, when time came to negotiate the release of Guru Har Gobind Sahib, who was sent? Our linguists and our granthi, because they were sober. Are you ready for that? This is the granthi level we need. This is the level of education. This is the level of awareness we need. This is what Pai Gurdas, they didn't just write Vara and Kapit and Samayye. They trained the next guru. They worked with them for years. And they dealt with the policies which needed to be changed. And I say this because it produced then a whole culture. And I've written just a few of them, samples here. These are what I would call people who wrote from a Sikh spirit. We generally talk about other writers. Read all of them. I read all of them. Earlier there was a reference to Hugh McClure's Who's a Sikh? I read that sitting in Creston when I was in 10th grade. And it was a powerfully written book. But I was very angry when I was reading it because it was not accurate. But I'm like, this guy, it chota ni bahut bada shatana. And he was. But he knew how to write well. And I like reading it. I read all of his books. He confused the whole Sikh identity. He coined the term which Indian constitution and since then SGPC's performers use for defining a Sikh. I've had two meetings with him. I don't want to get into him. My point is, let me actually put it very blanketly in the other way. If there was no Zafarnama, we would have been repeating what Aurangzeb said, not what Guru Gobind Singh said. It is so accurate. Yesterday, Professor Sahib was speaking in Gurdwara and he talked about documenting things. You better believe it. These are our documenters. They are not perfect, but they're excellent. We're not looking for perfect people. Perfect is the enemy of the good, they say, right? Don't look for perfect people. We're looking for excellent people in their field. Don't look at what they look like. Don't worry about that. Leave them alone. Look at what they deliver, what they give to the community. And these are our educators who were actually trying to present the Sikh thesis properly. And there are 5 case studies I have. You want your empowered people? Stop telling them what to become. You know, my Mata Gujari sent Chote Sahib, you know the Sahib, most of you. She didn't tell them what to say. Imagine this scenario that a Harvard-trained lawyer is available to you when you are going to be presented in the highest court of the land. They didn't have a Harvard-trained lawyer telling them what to say. All Mata Gujari said was, just remember who you are. Today, we love to tell our kids who we are. We like to even tell them what to say when somebody asks a question. Stop doing that. I actually say, why should kids listen to me? I'm all of those, and I'm saying, yeah, don't listen. Well, you know why? What have I done? From a Sikh perspective. We might have done good stuff from a, you know, career perspective, other things. But Sikhi is something else. In Sikhi, these are the role models available. You can become you want to be a lawyer? How about becoming one like this one Sikh scholar? You want to be, throw people off from us, engendering the stereotypes of women? How about becoming today's Mike Pablo? How about becoming a warrior like Baba Gurbakhsh Singh Nihang when he stays on the 6th attack of Abdali, Ahmad Shah Abdali? He attacked Darwaza 7 times and he died defending Darwaza. How about becoming a community leader, a poet, a writer, and I don't know, how do you even explain Pai Veer Singh? Yeah, there are ways to do this. And how about becoming somebody like Puran Singh? And this is not the Professor Puran Singh, this is the finger lord of Puran Singh. And let me mention something there. People don't tell us all the facts about individuals. This very same founder of Fingalwara, the one who took care of the lepers, and was an environmentalist leader before it was fashionable to be environmentalist. He's also the same guy when June 84 happened, sent his reward back to the president. He says, I'm not going to take this from a country which is going to destroy our places of worship. This is leadership. This is clarity. This is like when Guru Har Krishna at such a young age, goes to Delhi, but does not appear in the court of Aurangzeb, defying the state's orders. That's our heritage. Having this level of clarity, and then the ability and the capacity to do the right thing, we should really think about how to do this. So, I mean, there's some graphs, you can look at them. Essentially, what I'm saying is, what does success look like has also changed for us. So when we are saying our youth want to be successful, who doesn't want to be materially successful? We all want it. But the question is, what about other successes? How are we measuring success? In corporate world, even in my organization, we have metrics. What determines success? Have we even sit down in a family with our youngsters and have we developed what is success at age of 25, 30, 35? Or does it only have one criteria? How much money did you make? Because if that's the criteria, then that's what you get. And some youngsters might not like it, and then you say, it's a body rebel over. So you really have to think about these things. And perceptions of these things can change. I want to just mention something from T.H. Chopra's book. This is very instructive again. I want you to look at this, read it carefully, and all it's saying is, when you had children in other communities, Hindu and Muslim communities, by the time they were five, what was happening? And let me show you what he wrote about what was happening in the Sikh community. Now, what it's basically saying is, can you imagine, do you really want an empowered Sikh child who will come up to you and say, Dad, it's time for you to give up your life to protect the nation's destiny? That's what Gurdwara Singh did. Are you ready for that? Because that is the Sikh model. You'll probably slap the hell out of him. If you're Punjabi and Rajas, you'll probably call them Niana Persoonia Gala Gala. But this is the Sikh model. And now, let me just explain this for a second. Can you even imagine the relationship Guru Gobind Singh at that time, Gobind Rai, had with Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahib? I can guarantee you it wasn't what Maxwell calls a positional relationship. They did not position that I'm your dad and I'm the guru. Somebody has to feel, do the youngsters in our community feel enough empowerment, enough safe spaces in today's world for you to even have a constructive, tough conversation? Sikhs had developed this in their homes. They had developed this in their communities where you are ready to have a tough conversation. Civil and tough. You want to empower the youth, that's what the youth, this is what you got to do. This is what was happening in the guru's household. So what is Sikhi education? Well, Sikhi education is all this stuff, but gurus were going through these things. You know, sometimes you think gurus were not trained, they were trained. You know they went to school, you know they were talking. How can you have an incredible theological dialogue with your professor or teacher if you're not trained? They learned the languages. Basically, the same thing happens today. They learned what was needed. Guru Har Gobind Sahib was militarily trained as well. So there's an internal development and there's external development. Today, I would say we primarily have a little bit of external development, what pays the bills. Internal development, none of this stuff, the theology, the philosophy, and the history, they're not being utilized or understood or being read to develop ourselves. So what do we do today? First thing for the youth to nurture is help them develop a questioning attitude. Yes, that's the Sikh way. Don't say they ask too many questions. Say, you know what? I love it. You're asking me some decent tough questions. Because that's what Guru Nanak taught us. He in fact started Japji Sahib first 40 with two questions. And they're not trivial questions. Give such yara moya kipura. They're fundamental questions of life. Help them develop good questions. You have to be ready for that. That's what empowering is. Sade na hunda ki, you know, apa kehte ki sade vele ta jo paani khade rehte si ki us samne. But for khade rahe mein, don't expect them to be like this because guess what? The world is quickly changing and they don't give a damn and they're leaving your home. They're emptying the nest. And if you have prepared them while they are emptying the nest, they will know what kind of flight to take. That's what I was referring to earlier. If you didn't prepare them, You didn't help them deal with the tough questions. You didn't help them deal with the teenager mind. Then, you know, you're going to have a different conversation at 20, when they're 25, maybe 30. You'll be like, "Itna to kya ho gaya? Utna to kuch nahi hua, theek hai." "Na to kya ho gaya?" is the question. So questioning attitude, really, it's so important. We love it when we tell Guru Sakhiya. Well, that means we need to transfer that on ourselves. You want to empower them. If you cannot answer that question, it just basically means two things. Either you don't know, or you're so uncomfortable because it goes against your own lifestyle. That's all it means. So it's okay. We can say, "My son asks me questions. I talk to him. And I tell him, Yoda, you're right. Let's figure it out together." Why do we have to act like we are being pretentious? Right? We're deceiving ourselves. So youth empowerment will require every home and a community set up as a byproduct, where you actually say, "This is a really good question. There is no stupid question. The only stupid question is the one I didn't ask." We gotta develop that attitude. And with that questioning attitude, you deal with some serious things, and then you go towards developing everything, not just one area. Physically, Gurdwara should have gyms. This is what I say to every Gurdwara. I don't know why we don't have gyms. I mean, people like me, we keep giving more fatty acid to more fatty people. How is that a number? Think about it. Youth loves to work out. We should create some. Gurdwara did this. He said, "Let's have a khana next to the Gurdwara." I gave these ideas to people in South Hall. They finally put up a gym. They're like, "Okay, that's so much better. I'll give a sugar cut." You gotta give up some nice facility. You gotta think about what is needed. Guru Angad did it himself. Point is, you gotta have literary elements and you have to have some physical elements, external and internal. And please do not underestimate the power of music. This is the best shovel I can share with you. Guru Nanak Sahib spoke about it in English. He said, "You know, people say they're trying to discover God. Suddenly, they say, 'Parapuru Paul, they're going to be able to get the answer.'" It's the answer. He says, "Ikna naan na ved na ghi ras, ras kas na janam." We don't understand music, we don't understand literature, we don't even understand a single syllable. Yet, we are looking for finer than the finest so called divine. How will you have? And you know what Guru Nanak said? Guru Nanak Sahib said, "Nanak tena asal tha." Asli gale hain Punjabi ke andar. Asli gale ta hone. My point is, these are two things in the world change the perception the most. African-American experiment in America shows that very clearly. You put your people in music and sports, you're going to change the way community looks at it. You're going to get most of your rights. It doesn't matter whether somebody likes it or not. And I say this in America, part of this will be applicable here. I have lots of doctors in my family, and engineers, and lawyers, and I tell them, "What perceptions have you changed? Or have you just built up more stereotypes?" You gotta have people in music. Guru Nanak had a musician with him. Music transcends boundaries of all kinds. And Mardana was a Muslim man of the so-called low-caste Muslim. In India, everything's got a caste, which is oxymoron and Islam otherwise. Just like us, it's an oxymoron among Sikhs, but we all love our caste, which means we have never left the old way. We're still operating in the old way. Point here is, this faculty is so important. I cannot tell you how important this is. We gotta have some element of music in our lives. If you can go into classicals and Gurmukh Sangeets, I would love to be trained by Gurdecha brothers on Dhrupad as well. Right? Maybe some of you have never even heard of that. That's the kind of stuff you have to think about. And maybe the dream should be, my son's going to play the piano at Radio City Music Hall in New York City. That's how we have to dream. You know the community, and this is about youth empowerment. Community whose dreams are smaller than their memories, they're already dead. Today's Sikh community has more memory of past than their dreams. Your dream has to be bigger than your memory. Iqbal ka ek sher hai ga Urdu jo kehta hamari to dosti hi unon se hai jo dekhte hain khwab sare tod denge. You gotta dream big. We don't even dream big anymore. Our elders did. Our gurus did. The youngsters, they were empowering. They dreamed big. They took on what world said cannot be done. They said, let's go do it. We want that attitude. That attitude is developed through these kind of things as well. Training of language. We're totally out of this now. The first way to enslave any community anywhere in the world is to get them to not converse, associate, listen in their language. You can pick up a sociologist from the University of Chicago. I mention University of Chicago because they produce most Nobel laureates now. And they'll tell you this. This is the number one thing. You look at Minorities at Risk Project at the University of Maryland. You look at anything. They'll tell you, if you don't have your language, Mark Twain said this. You want to make somebody a slave, take their language away, produce the books for them. By the time third generation comes, they'll accept whatever is written. Guess what? It's happening with us right now. Because we don't know the original. We don't know the language. Mother tongue, language, Gurmukhi script, whatever you want to call it, they have to come into our system. And I'm not rigid on these things. I don't buy, I don't, you know, some people say, oh, only, we'll tell this to you. They don't jump in the boat. We gotta know, we must know Punjabi, we gotta learn Gurmukhi, but we gotta learn all the languages possible to us. And then they, you know, traditionalists will cite Rahatnamis say, Gurmukhi akhar jo hai bhai, Singh Singh nam te sikhan jai. I said, what's the next line? Because they don't like to talk about the next line. You know, the next line itself, aur bhi paakya sikhya nahi. Go learn the other languages, because number one issue is communication, not which language. The reason you need to know your language is so you can study the original freshness, rather than relying on horribly bad Sikhi to the max translation. I run workshops on that too, that sometimes they are diametrically opposing to what the original idea is. You got to know who's done that translation and where, what was his training. Can you imagine among six, we have had six or seven English translations, three Punjabi ones, yet we don't even have a complete dictionary, which Dr. Gurcharan Singh completed only 6 years ago. How good can those translations be? Just think about it. I mean, they're shooting in thin air in most cases. But anyway, coming back, we also have to worry about the gender dynamics. There is so much engendering in a community. You want to empower people, you've got to worry about. Don't just use male images. Don't just use particular kind of male images. Use her in sentences rather than his or he all the time. This is the kind of educational stuff we have to bring in our system. Words matter. I'm sure some of you are lawyers and don't say it's semantics only. Every lawyer will tell you, you know how you win the case? Semantics. So let's not create, you know, kid ourselves. Semantics matter. The word choice matter. Professor Puran Singh has written an article that you know what Guru Nanak spoke? Some of you, us might be speaking, but the way he said it, there was a genius personality standing behind it, which is the values. You gotta have the values, our tongues, the vocabulary matters, and the women child definitely matters. I just cannot stress this enough. I put a few examples here. We might not even know these people. You know, when Hariram Gupta had to write 5-volume history of the Sikhs, he had to look for the library, he had to go to Takht Singh Library, we call it, but we don't even mention Agya Kaur and Anandpur's name. They were the pioneers who were married to him. One night, so he married again. They created the best library of the Sikhs. Today, we don't even have a single library in the world where somebody can go study about Sikhs. There are a few existing universities here and there, a comprehensive library, where you have all sources. Women were putting this together 100 years ago for us, in the middle of Punjab. You know why? Because at that time, there was a renaissance going on. Every single novel by Ngee Singh wrote, every single one, the protagonist is a woman. He was doing this in 1900s, early 1900s. Now we even change the name sometimes, but I tell you, read them. If you even read Jira Ahmed, the most common one, you know, the title is Baba Not Singh, that's not the complete title. It's also about a woman. A single mother, sometimes we call it, but she wasn't even a mother. Her husband had died, and he described even in the first chapter how every religious personality looks at that woman as a prey, how the lawyer looks at her. How the community looks at her. And that's the opening of the novel. Sohag does. Sohag is a man. 100 years ago, we were so progressive that every single Punjabi novel which was written, it was written from a women protagonist, female protagonist. And where we are today, now we are discussing whether a young woman, just imagine the impact, negative impact this causes when we are discussing whether a woman can even do a Kirtan and Darbar Sahib complex. What kind of utter nonsense is this? This is happening because you and I are not able to create these kind of resources. When the education was, in British census of 1900, Punjab was rated number one in education. When you have educated people, they're going to do some serious work. Today we don't have that. It's starting to happen again, there's a resurgence, revival happening a little bit. And look what happens when you have educated community. Your political problem, your religious exemptions of Kirpan, your separate identity of Anand Karaj. Same issues in the news, but we don't know how to deal with them today. Whether it's in India or in England, if you've seen the Sunny Hundred's posts on interfaith marriages. These are serious issues again. We have lost what we did 100 years ago. There's undoing in the last 70 years. Because you and I have not empowered our individuals to think about how to deal with all these. So what are the lessons for today? We started at 10:10, I'll finish at 11:10. Well, first thing is, we really have to understand what are the principles. Do we know the foundational principles of Sikhi? And I can guarantee you, we will have a tough time coming up with that. We all love to tell our kids, you know, punch ke's ne and four don'ts ne. That's the wrong way to talk about things. It's like asking Bill Gates, tell me something about Microsoft. Is he going to tell you the year he was incorporated? Is he going to tell you, you know, how his programmers have to follow certain, you know, TCP/IP or whatever the internet protocols and programming protocols are? When somebody asks us about Sikhi, we tell them this, our bylaws. When somebody asks about Sikhi, we should be talking about how we changed the lives in South Asia. How we started treating every single person as divine. Which means all 7 billion people today. This is what gurus work on. These are our foundational principles. We don't have our foundational principles now. Doesn't matter what the world thinks, we carry these foundational principles with us. Doesn't matter when we were being assassinated, genocide en masse, half a population was killed, Sikh population, twice in about 1740s and 1760s. One time it was 2/3 of the population. Even then we did not give up our foundational principles. 780 men with Banda Singh Bahadur chose death and did not give up the foundational principle. And what are those? I want, as community, some focus on that and give that to the youngsters. That's where Sikhi is really missing. The models are the gurus. Every other model is going to fail. Models are the gurus. They showed us how you can do it in the toughest time, even when your family sucks, and gurus' family sucked many a time. And their own brothers conspired with the state to kill them and their son. Like in the case of Guru Arjan. In the case of Guru Tegh Bahadur, they hired a hitman to kill him. His name was Singh. Even in those times, they figured out how to give values, how to remain completely focused on the foundational principles. Today, we don't know the foundational principle. We want superficial identity to look like one. Let me tell you, with youngsters this makes sense. I'm sure, I hope it makes sense with you. If you like basketball, you like Michael Jordan, you buy his jersey, you buy his shoes, and you put those on, you sit on your ass on the sofa, you're not going to be Michael Jordan. You got to take your ass on the court, you got to practice and shoot, maybe you'll get there. And this is what we do now. We buy the paraphernalia and we think we've become Michael Jordan. Empowerment happens when you actually think with the idea, not talk about the idea. Today we'd like to talk about Sikhi as a project. The most powerful ideas are the ones you think with, not you think about. We are not thinking with Sikhi. It is not happening in our own households, in our communities. And this is where this language, heritage, and culture and other things come in. One of my most favorite t-shirts is Unlearn. Because when I started reading Guru Granth Sahib, at some point I did a Sahaj Paath without a deadline. I stress without a deadline. Because we have deadlines and we don't know what we are reading most of the time. Once I finished it, it took me about 7 months. like, hold on. I was about 21 at that time, and I'm like, you know, what I've just learned in these last 7 months, this is diametrically opposing to what I've been told. We have a lot of learning to do. Gurbani kehndi hai, je koi hor ras leke aana, then inu khali karna pehna. E par ditta gaya hun cheezan de naal. Oh, jo sanu par ditta gaya is what? And you can read it up here. Essentially, we have been bombarded with certain elements of Sikhi, which I would say don't find rooms in Guru Granth Sahib. So what we have to do is, we have to do unlearning. How does unlearning happen? The first thinking is, first step in unlearning is, do you even want to learn? Because most of us don't want to. We don't like to think. Go stare yourself in the mirror tomorrow and then you'll see you can't even stand yourself for 30 seconds. Because we get scared. We start to see what we look like internally. I would say, if I'm working with my experiment with my kids. Let me share one story here. I've been trying to teach, and at home we have this conversation. My wife thinks I'm not as traditional anymore. I'm like, what do you mean anymore? She's like, you know, you're not teaching them part. I said, you are. Why do you need to repeat? I said, I want to teach Jola what thankfulness is. And I'm struggling with that. I want to teach him he should be colorblind, quote unquote, when he looks at people. Whether somebody keeps hair or not. Whether it's his cousin or a friend in a school. I want to teach him those things. And Sikhi comes in after. You know, today we like to compare, you know, some youngsters say this, and I'll have to confront that as well. We like to say, I just want to be a good human being. Well, who's stopping you? Become good human being is not in competition with being a Sikh. You have to be a good human being before you decide to follow another blueprint. It's a requirement to be a good human being. Then you have archetypes in the world. You know, Carl Jung created his ideas. Nietzsche had his own Superman idea. And Rumi had his own idea of Mardekada. It's a conscious choice what blueprint you, what GPS you want in your life. And all those GPS require you to be a good human being. Good human being is where things start, not where they end. Then the next step is, now what political or religious or any other ideology, maybe Richard Dawkins is your God. It's okay if he is. But it's a conscious choice you have to make. And that conscious choice requires, even in Sikhi, let me come back to Sikhi, you got to do a lot of unlearning. And one of the unlearning, major unlearning you might have to do is, and I'll just say it, you know, goal in Sikhi is not to go to heaven. That's one unlearning you have to do. Because everyone is selling heaven. You know why? It's the biggest business. You know why? Because nobody comes back to ask for their money back. So people just want to go there. You want to get an expert in heaven? Sikhi vijay hai ni. Asi bhi lagi ja rahe. So that's major unlearning. What is your end goal? Sikhi, the end goal is, I want to be just like the Force, back to Star Wars. I want to be like the Divine. That's the goal in Sikhi. I'm not looking for a paradise or a paradise lost, whatever else you're looking for. So first you have to ask, is this what the goal is? My behavior needs to be divine behavior. Whatever divine is, whatever Ikumankar means to you. If this is the goal, then your whole model changes. If the goal is to get to heaven, you have separate options. And we are in the marketplace of ideas, as Nietzsche says, and everything is selling. And his conclusion was, God is dead in this marketplace of ideas. He was critiquing the 18th century Germany. Oh, sorry, 19th century, middle of 1800s. Same thing will be said today. If Guru Nanak walks in here today, I'm sure most Sikhs will kick him out, because he's going to ask some very tough questions. We have to do a lot of unlearning. And this is our Gurdwara, the Darbar Sahib complex. Picture from 1900s, first decade. Guess what they did? Even when they didn't have classrooms, they were teaching. Now we have nice auditorium, classrooms. Gurdwara board has put together good facilities in Singapore. You guys are ahead of the curve. You already got brick and mortar. The next thing is, what kind of glue do you want to bring in here now? What kind of taksar? Quote unquote. Taksal is where you mint. Question is, what are you minting? What is the dream here that the Singapore Sikhs in next 10 years, 5 years, what contributions they will have to the community here? Are they going to act like the establishment, or are they going to fight for the rights of unestablished or disestablished? These are the questions you have to seriously think about. How do we train them? How do we really train them from the ideas of Sikhi? Do we want them to become a thinkers of Sikhi, or you want them to follow, become the protocol followers of Sikhi? Because that's what we're doing. I use an analogy, and I'm ending here now. We want our kids to become gun cleaners. Just hear me out. What's a gun cleaner? He gets up every day, cleans his gun. Next day, he cleans his gun again. That's what we do. We say, this is the simran, this is the part, and we want kids to do this. You know what a soldier does? Soldier also does the same thing every day. But he does it because when there is needed, how we use it. Now, in Sikhi, we do the part, we do the simran, we never use it. We are just the gun cleaners. Because we need to use it every day, in every conversation, in every relationship, in solving the family issues, community issues, national, international issues. Maybe the dream needs to be, you know, whenever Singapore opens up, which political dissident parties you're going to be part of. The dream needs to be, if we have the next 10 doctors, how many of are joining physicians for human rights? When you're going to have a next musician, are they also going to do concerts for people who can't afford? Things to think about. So youth empowerment and nurturing at the end of the day is not really about what final product you want to develop. It's about developing capacity. FDR in America said, you measure leadership not by how many years you rule, but how many good leaders you have developed. That's what gurus were after. Gurus, that's why, did not develop the new art. Think about it historically. This is very important to think about. Because their goal was, we want to develop different kind of an artist. We don't want to tell the artist what to draw. We want to fill the artist of any kind with such an inspiration, such a genius, that whatever he or she does will be incredible, whether they play the flute or whether they pick up the khanda. And they were different. So our job is to facilitate the development, not telling them what to become. Thank you.